Well, good evening, everybody. Good to see you. Thank you for coming out tonight on this kind of a rainy, not kind of a rainy, but just a wet old evening, isn't it? But it's dry in here, and I hope that when I say it's dry in here that I don't have anything to say about my sermon being dry. I hope that it'll be beneficial to you and helpful to you. I'm enjoying this time together, and I hope that you are as well. We had a unique experience this morning that I might tell you about whenever we think about missions and the work of First Baptist Church, and that is, and some of you noticed it, I know, but after the offering this morning, well then, Carol and I slipped out. Now, whenever you see us sitting over there, keep an eye on us, because we're going to sneak out. That's the reason we do that, sit over there. But at any rate, Montana, Russ and Kim's fine son, was going to be baptized down at Eastland this morning. And we've known the family and been friends of the family, and I've talked with Montana some, and he wanted me to know about it, and I thought, when he wants me to know about it, I think he wants me to be there, and I wanted to be there. So we went down, and you know that we were at Eastland, and Eastland was a mission off of First Baptist Church. First Baptist built it there on 3rd Street. And many of you, by the way, were members there. And it was just a blessing to go back. I hadn't been back in years and years and years and years and years. But it was a blessing, and Carol and I enjoyed it very, very, very much. And they call it Life now, Life Church. That's not bad. Life. Jesus said, "I've come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly." And I'm gonna tell you what, a bunch of them there believe they've got that abundant life. I'm here to tell you, and we just enjoyed it. I'm going in a little bit of a different direction tonight. We are looking at the New Agers tonight, the New Age movement tonight. And I don't have the PowerPoint on the screen for you, but I have the scripture passage on the screen for you. So we're going to start off. Give me Genesis, please, chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. You know, I don't know whether you notice this as we go through these. Now, we've had Islam, and we've had the Mormons, and we're just kind of going through these different groups like that of world religions. We've had the mystical Eastern religions of Buddhism and Hinduism and Confucianism and all the isms like that. And one of the things about it, it seems that appeals, is to be God, or to be like God. You know, the Mormons say, as man is now, God once was. As God is now, man can become. And so there's that idea of becoming God. And so the New Agers picked up on that, and under the name of New Age, but they could have called himself Old Age, because, see, if you notice, in the scripture passage tonight that this is an appealing thing to mankind. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, "Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman," did God actually say, "you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, the woman here, of course, is Eve, "we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die." Now, I don't believe God said anything about touching it, so that was kind of added to it there, "but you shall not eat of that." But the serpent said to the woman, "you will not surely die." And so here you have the idea of doubting what God has said, okay? "For God knows when you eat it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Look at that. You will be like God. "So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. And the eyes of both were opened, and they knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths." Let's bow together, please, for prayer. Heavenly Father, speak to our hearts tonight and let us look into your word and not only our Heavenly Father find out in our situation and our day of that which is untrue, but that which is true. And may we cleave to the truth and stand in the truth and declare the truth, our Heavenly Father, with holy boldness in our life's journey. And we'll thank you and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The New Age movement has caught hold and seems like it's making itself really known in the upward part of our society, of the up and outs. You know, there are up and outs and there's down and outs. But the New Agers seems to be more in the up and outs, and in many, many ways, it latched on to Silicon Valley and to the California group and to the Hollywood group. I could mention the name of Tom Cruise. I could mention the name of Jerry Seinfeld. I could mention the name of Kirsten Alley. I said, well, I couldn't think of her last name. I said to Carol while I was sitting there, I said, "What Kirsten? What's Kirsten that was on Cheers? What's her last name?" And she said, "Allie." And she said, "What do you want to know that for?" And I said, "I don't know. I was just sitting here and I was just thinking about her." She, I just got one of them from her. Yeah. "Why are you thinking about Kirsten Alley?" I said, "Well, because she's a New Ager. She's a New Ager." And then, of course, there's Shirley MacLaine. Shirley MacLaine was a smiling face on the cover of Time magazine, and the subhead on it read, "Faith healers, Chandlers, space travelers, and crystals galore." And so we find millions of people are becoming involved in this thing which is called the New Age movement. It has become popular enough that someone who was an advocate of it would be on the front page of Time magazine because that she is an advocate of it. Shirley MacLaine, as a spokesman for the New Agers, has sold 8 million copies of her books. 8 million copies. Now, you think about that. And made many, many movies. And in her movies, she always seems to try to instill in that some kind of a thought that goes along with New Age. Bantam Books reports the New Age book titles have increased tenfold in 10 years, and about 20% now, we're told, of Fortune 500 companies in this country are devoting budget dollars for New Age-related seminars for their employees, and many are attending them. Did you know that a Gallup poll revealed that approximately 25% of the people in our country believe in some form of reincarnation? Did you know that there are many, many people that follow what is called channeling, channelers, And in the Los Angeles area alone, I told you California was strange, that there are over 1,000 Chandlers in that area alone who for a fee claim they'll get in touch with some person who has died and will channel their words of wisdom and come to you. Did you know that all over the United States, every weekend, the seminars attack tens of thousands of people, this thing called the New Age movement? Well, it's so. Well, what about it? What do they believe, and why is this movement growing so rapidly? What do they have that would appeal to mankind? Now, these are just a few of the questions that I'm going to take a shot at this evening and try to share with you. But as in other things, this is a difficult thing to do. These world religions are very difficult because with the New Age movement, it's not a single organization. It doesn't have a single identifiable leader. There are some very prestigious, as far as the world concerned, people that are involved in it. But if you would try to find somebody that is the leader of it, you would be hard put to do so. It's a group of people that hold somewhat similar beliefs. They're fed with seminars, tapes, and magazines, and there are some unifying themes of the movement. So we mention them under the heading tonight of what do New Agers believe. So I want to go through this reasonably quick with you tonight. First of all, New Agers believe that the New Age God is an impersonal force. The New Age God is an impersonal force. The idea of a personal God has been abandoned for the idea of an impersonal force. There's no relationship here. There's no Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. It's just the idea of a cosmic power that can be tapped into if you know how. The God of this New Age is a cosmic consciousness that you can learn how to tap into this. And even more serious, the New Agers are pantheistic in their view of God. God is all, they say, and all is God, and all is one. And everything that exists is an expression of the essence of God. There's a universality about every matter and about this pulpit, in a rock, in a tree, in an animal. And this is a major theme of the New Age movement. Now, number two, the New Age teaching makes human beings God. Makes human being God. Now you want to hold on to your hat here, or your purse, or whatever you want to hold on to, because they believe there is a universal force found everywhere and in everything, and that this godness that is in everything is in you and is in me, and therefore, without shame or hesitation or apology, then the New Agers believe that human beings are God. Now, this is kind of like the Hindus. Remember I told you the Hindus say it to bow. They say the spirit that is within me bows to the spirit that is within you, or the God that is within me bows to the God that is in you. But you see, they say that most human beings haven't discovered that yet, and they desperately need to be what? They say they need to be enlightened. Enlightened. That's their word. And if we just had more people, they say, that are aware of their divinity, then the whole world would be a better place and all of us would be enlightened to understand who we really are, and that is that we're gods. I told you that Shirley MacLaine always tries to include this in some of her movies, and since you have heard this, if you see her now on a rerun, you will notice that somewhere along the line she brings this in, and one in particular, she comes up out of a pool and she says, I'm God, I'm God, I've finally gained an awareness of my goodness. And they say that once that happens, then you can create your own destiny, you can arrange future affairs. You might be wondering then, well, where do they get these ideas? Who is telling those people these truths? Now, that's number three then. They believe that there is no single source of New Age group. No single source. Since we are Christians, And if someone would ask us what our source of truth is, well, then you'd get a two-word answer. And it would be the Bible. Isn't that right? What is our source of truth? Our source of truth is the Bible. We've learned that since we were little children. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. The Bible is a single, inspired volume that has stood the test of time. It explains the Christian faith. It explains the nature of God, the nature of man, the nature of the world. But for the New Ager, any kind of a single truth is much too narrow. And so if you ask the New Ager what source he gets his truth from, he would say, well, my truth comes from my guru. And they say, well, where did he get his truth from? And he said, well, he got his truth from a guru as well. Well, where did he get his truth from? And on and on and on it goes. Kind of like the fellow one time, they asked what he believed. He said, well, I believe what my preacher believes. And they said, well, what does your preacher believe? And he said, well, he believes what our church believes. I said, well, what does your church believe? He said, well, we all believe the same thing. And so it just kind of goes around and around. And that's kind of the way that it is with them. It just goes back and it goes back. And then they can go back to this celebrated master teacher that translates truth, and you say, "Well, where do they get it?" And they go back to about the 15th century to a monk from Tibet whose wisdom can be tapped through a process called channeling. And so you see, for a fee, a channeler will quieten themselves and go into what appears to be a trance. And their bodies go limp, and they claim that they tune in to the vibrations of the universe, and they can pick up some knowledge being transmitted by someone who lived in that day and in that time. And then whatever this 15th century person will say is truthful things, and the channeler will be the conduit, and you can get truth for yourself in that way. Somebody else says, my truth comes from meditation. It's not the kind of meditation the Bible talks about in Psalm chapter 1. Blessed is the man, you know, and he meditates in the Word of God both day and night. Christian meditation for the Christian is a very thoughtful and concentrated effort which we seek to understand the depth of God's truth and how that we can receive it unto ourselves. We don't empty ourselves. We receive the fullness of God in our meditation. But for them, it is to totally empty their mind. Empty their mind and to make the mind available to somebody, somewhere, to deposit some kind of a truth. Now, that's a dangerous thing. You know, somebody says, well, I don't know whether it's all that important that I really believe the truth or not. Well, if you don't believe the truth, you'll believe a lie. Now, everybody will believe something. Did you know that? You can't just say, I'm not going to believe anything. If you say you're not going to believe anything, you believe something, and the something you believe is nothing. You say, I just don't believe anything. But yet, that is where your faith is. And so they just believe if they can empty their mind, then that which comes into their mind will be channeled. As a matter of fact, Shirley MacLaine said that whenever she plays the part of somebody of another day that are no longer living, well, then she yields herself to their spirit, and rather than receiving inspiration from their life, she lets them channel their lives through her. And so then she becomes them. Someone said the absence of a correct truth source is a recipe for moral anarchy. The absence of a truth source is a recipe for moral anarchy. I read a very interesting illustration, not an illustration, but a story of a man who was in the New Age movement. He had been there about 5 years, and he left it, and he had a genuine conversion to Christianity. And that's what he called it. He said it was moral anarchy. He said, we used to sit around in a group, and we would talk about what my truth was. It's kind of like we Baptist folk. We'd be maybe in a small group, and somebody would give a testimony and another testimony, but they would call it their truth. I've heard of people saying, my God does this, or my God does that. Have you ever heard of that? You know, somebody say, my God. I heard Oprah Winfrey said, you know, her Jesus would not do this. Her Jesus was not like that. Well, the Jesus she was talking about was not the Jesus of the Bible, see. And so they're swapping out truth. And he said that in this group that night, there was a young woman there that said her truth was to get married. And she was young, and she was attractive. So he decided that his truth was to leave his wife, to divorce his wife, and to marry this woman. And so he told his wife that was his truth. And, of course, she was very, very upset about it. And he said, but, honey, that's my truth. Well, how do you argue with that? And then in the meanwhile, a very clever Christian come along and told him that he attended a New Age church. And he said, you do? He said, yes, I do. He said, I'll go with you. And this was a good church that he attended. And so he took this fellow with him to church, and there at the church, the pastor preached a message about human beings standing morally accountable and acceptable before a holy God. And in this sermon, he became conscious for the first time of the reality of sin, and he knew he was playing games, and he said, I was just making up the truth. That's all I was doing, just manufacturing the truth for myself so I could live the way I wanted to live. And he said, the next morning, I fell on my knees, and I received Christ, and I received forgiveness. And then he said, you'll never know. If you haven't been involved in the New Age movement, the grip, the power that it can have over you. So, New Agers, there's no single source of the truth. What do they believe about the afterlife? Here they're almost in total agreement. They believe in reincarnation. They don't tend to believe as the Hindus that one goes lower, but they're more optimistic, and they increase no losing in their reincarnation. They always seem like they get better and better because they're in the New Age and always upward flowing with the God that is in you until you reach the universe kind of spirit form forever. And then you just go into that, and that's shouting ground for them. They just think that's the ultimate. That's the greatest thing that they can ever be, is just to get into this spirit, cosmos spirit of the universe. Now, what do they believe about Jesus Christ? Well, here again, it's difficult to define, but one of the popular notions of it is that Jesus Christ was a good human being upon whom a special and concentrated life energy descending. It's called Christ consciousness. They believe that Jesus was born to a physical father and mother, a total denial of the virgin birth. In fact, because the Bible only traces the life of Jesus between his birth and age 12, and then there's this blank, you know, until he's about 30 years of age, they believe that in the intervening 18 years, Jesus spent time in India studying under gurus. Now, there's some truth for you, isn't it? And as a result of these studies, according to them, a form of Christ Messiah consciousness descended on him, as it did with Buddha, as it will on us if we become more enlightened. And so that's just the tip of the iceberg of New Age beliefs. Wouldn't you agree that they differ radically with anything that we in turn believe the Bible teaches? How would you line this up with I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me, said Jesus? How would you line this up with 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 5? There's one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. Or John chapter 1, he came into his own, and his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Or John chapter 3, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. The prophet Isaiah said, he was wounded for our transgression, he was bruised for our iniquity, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Or John 3:16, it simply says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus said in John chapter 8 and verse 24, if you believe not that I am he, you will die in your sins. And so here we are, coexist. Here we are, toleration. Legal toleration. It's legal in our land for someone to believe that if they choose to. Social toleration. If they move in as our next door neighbor, we're to treat them as we want to be treated. But not intellectual. Not intellectual toleration. They believe God is an impersonal force. Christianity teaches that we have a personal Father. They believe that man is God unaware. We believe just the opposite, that God is the creator and man is the creature. Let's not be mistaken about who is who. Man was created in the image of God, but man is not God, and man never will be God. Truth is as they see it. For us, truth is what God declares it to be. The future for the New Agers is reincarnation. For Christianity, it's appointed and a man wants to die. And after this, the judgment, the Bible declares. Jesus Christ, the New Ager, says he's a good man with a Christ consciousness for a period of time. Christian says he is the Son of God. He is the only Savior for mankind. So why are they so appealing? Why are they so appealing? You remember back some years ago, there was a movement, and I never did really understand this movement, to tell you the truth about it, but somebody come up with a stupid thing that God was dead. You remember that? God is dead. And the God of the Christian, the God of the world, the God as we understand God is dead, and he is no more. And that kind of ran its pace. And then the old idea of pantheism surfaced again, that God is everywhere. And if God was dead, then people became atheists. There is no God, but pantheism says God is everywhere, and so they like the idea of that God, I can be God. I can be God. God is in me. I can be God. And it comes from one of the strongest drives known to man, and I hate to say it, but it's not the sex drive, but it is to be God. To be God. That's the way it was. Remember we read that in Genesis chapter 3? He knows the day you'll eat thereof, you'll be like God. Satan said, I will rise up and I will be like the Most High God. And there's just something about man that wants to think more highly of himself than he should. These six things does the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look is number one. A proud look. And they feed that pride in mankind. The New Age movement is morally unchallenging. They can say, this is my truth, and do anything that they don't get arrested for, you know. It's morally unchallenging. Who are you? Who are you to say to me what I do is not right? This is my truth. I have been given this truth. They have told me this truth. You remember Tom Cruise, whenever he divorced his last wife, and you remember the Scientology, and how that he got in trouble to a degree with that, and they believed that it was them that was feeding that to him, that he needed to leave this woman and he needed to marry another woman. Just kind of go with the morals of life as you want to do so. It's appealing because of the promise of an optimistic future. They teach them they can do it. They can do it. You can be this. You can be this. And the last one, I hate to say this, because I believe that it's because of the failure of Christian churches to demonstrate and present the truth of biblical Christianity. The failure of Christian churches to demonstrate and to present the truth of biblical Christianity. Now just think with me. We read from Genesis chapter 3. And where that man was in the creation had fellowship with God, God would meet with them there in the garden. And they sinned. And they went and hid from God. And God came looking for them. God came looking for them. Jesus said, I've come to seek and to save that which was lost. I heard a preacher preach one time, and he was talking about in the creation that God was getting ready to make a man. And the angel said to God, said, what you doing? And he said, I'm going to make a man. And he said, What's he going to do? Why are you going to make him? And he said, I'm going to make him so he'll choose to love me. I'm going to make him so he'll love me. And I want that to be a free moral choice in turn that he would make. And then, of course, man fell. And God began his great plan of redemption. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, for by one man sin entered into the world, and sin by death, death by sin. So by one man, life came, and that's through the Lord Jesus Christ. Man is so special to God. Created by God, Christ died for mankind, for you, for me. His Spirit lives in us. Oh, how special man is. But we have a job. And our job is to tell people about Jesus, folks. That's our job. To tell people about Jesus. The Great Commission, go ye therefore into all the world. Didn't say wait till they come to you. Go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that he was buried, and that he raised again on the third day. The gospel wherein we're saved. The Bible says the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. And somewhere along the line, we've lost this. I'm not talking about here. I'm just preaching. We've lost this. He that winneth souls is wise. How beautiful are the feet of those that preach the gospel. Go about talking about Jesus as the Savior of the world. Gonna be wintertime. Wintertime's coming on. And you know, let me tell you something. You know, one of the first things that'll get cold about you is your feet. And when your feet get cold, you may as well go to the house. When your feet get cold. And I wonder how many people tonight I'm preaching to that's got cold feet. And you might do everything in the world to try to warm them up, you know, but you don't talk about Jesus to people. And if anybody would ask you what's the greatest thing that ever happened to you in all your life, you'd be very, very quick. The greatest thing that ever happened to me, I would hope you would say, when I got saved. So what's the greatest thing then you could ever do for somebody else? Would be to tell them how to be saved. Or to work to get them saved. Something has happened. Something happens in my life, in our life. I don't know what it is, but I can't put my hand on it. But in this burden for souls, the Apostle Paul said, "My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. I bear great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart for Israel." But a lot of churches will go through a week and never really talk to anybody about Jesus. About Jesus. And we come to church and the pastor preaches and the invitation is given. There's not a lost soul. You preach a revival, I preach a revival. There's lost. And so then we start having Bible conferences. We just feed the sheep. We just feed the sheep. Daniel says in chapter 12 and verse 3, "And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever." Jesus said in Matthew 4:19, "Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men." That's not hard to understand, is it? Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Down to Eastland this morning. Eastland really grew back years ago. It really grew. It did. And used to see somebody, we taught the folks soul winning. They'd go soul winning. Soul winning. And you'd see somebody there you never saw before, and they'd have a paper sack. You know what they had in that sack? Clothes and a towel. Clothes and a towel. And I don't know how many times I've had somebody come and say, "Pastor, I got one coming forward this morning. I got somebody coming forward this morning." And we kept watering the baptistry. Just kept watering the baptistry. I went to a church one time, had somebody saved, and I was going to baptize them. They said, "Oh, you can't baptize." I said, we got a committee, and you got to meet with the committee. I ain't knocking it. We got a meeting. You got to meet with the committee. And we got to have anyway a 2-week notice on this. I thought, oh my, no. They that gladly received His word were baptized. And it just seems like when this happens in a church, well, then you just leave feeling good about the church. You say, "Man, you need to come to my church. You need to come to church where I go to church." And then, of course, there needs to be unity in the church. We all need to work for unity in the church and the witness of the church and the power of the Holy Spirit in the church. And all of these people, listen, all these people, the Islam folks and the Mormons and the Hindus and the Buddhists and the New Agers and the up and outs, the down and outs, and the no outs, and you know what they're like? They're like a sheep with no shepherd. They're like a sheep with no shepherd. Heard Dr. Aidan Rogers tell a story one time, and I closed with this. And he said they were out at a place, and like at a beach, and there was boats there, and they were having a good time. Everybody there darting here and there in little runabout boats, and there was a collision. And there was a person that was really hurt very severely, and they had this person up on the bank. And they were working with him, trying to see what was wrong, and trying to get an ambulance, trying to get some help. And the fellow, he was just rather nonchalantly walking around the beach, and he just happened to walk over by there, and he looked by there, and he says, "My goodness," he said, "that's my brother. Do something, somebody. That's my brother. Do something." Am I my brother's keeper? Are we not? And has not God called us to passionately love others to a relationship with Jesus Christ, that they in turn might be saved, that they might be saved? I used to think, I don't know what's happened to me, I used to think that if the Bible says in the book of Acts, the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved, then why on earth couldn't we get somebody saved every week? Why couldn't we? Well, you know we could. Wouldn't you like that, Mario? Wouldn't you like that? My soul, baptized. Get our feet warm. And I really believe that more than anything else, that's what opens the door for all of this wildness, wild belief and no belief. Because a lot of people have never really seen a church. And I believe that we come out here to be that church. And I believe you're a part of that church, you know. And you can't answer for everybody else, but you can answer for yourself. And you can't fuss at anybody and get them to do something, but you can challenge somebody and make them do a lot. And I'm just telling you, this is something you can do, and I'll challenge you to that. And if we just take the folks that are here tonight, if you just think of somebody that you know that's lost, and you just really pray for them and love them and be kind to them and take the initiative with them and get them under the sound of the gospel, and you'll be so glad when they're saved. Let's bow our head together. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can say those three words, our Heavenly Father. Our Father who art in heaven. The words of the psalmist, the Lord is my shepherd, not a cosmic force, but the Lord of glory, loved us with a never-ending love, and said that we're to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength, and our brother as ourselves. I pray tonight that we'll take that challenge to do exactly that. To love the Lord, our God, with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, and to love our brethren and our sisters as ourselves, and that we might, our Heavenly Father, be that light here in Metropolis that shines forth in the darkness, that Jesus is the light of the world, the changer of lives, and the Savior of mankind. Help us to be aware, like we tell the little kids in their sports, play heads up. Let's be heads up about our Christianity. and not give the a lie a head start, but to head it off with the truth. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.